attend a very well attended meeting down there then, and we will want to see him back in the new year whenever that's possible, and we'll have a, you'll have a mass meeting for that as well. And all I can say really is that we have got to continue this campaign. And I welcome all the people here tonight. I don't know if how many are here from local circumstances or not, but it doesn't really matter. You're here to hear justice. And you're here to hear the campaign for justice and the reason for justice. And that's what's most important of all, that in the end, you have to have justice. There's been so many campaigns throughout the years, throughout the same period really, 70s and beyond, where justice has been denied, but not so far in the case of the Shrewsbury pickets, and in particular, Desi Warren and Ricky Tomlinson. They have got to be exonerated, and that needs to be done as soon as possible, sooner rather than later. So I applaud the campaign that's continuing. I think we should all do so. I think that there would be more people from London Trades Councils and other people around the country. It's a reasonably short notice meeting this is, and I understand the importance of that. But when there are bigger meetings being called, there will be bigger attendances and there will be greater demands. So I look forward to the justice of Shrewsbury 2 in particular, Des Warren and Ricky Tomlinson. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Touched on the fact that tonight's meeting is about the Shrewsbury 2, Des Warren and Ricky Tomlinson. Because if you look at the time, if you look at the time of the arrest and the fight that these two put in, be put in prison because they knew they weren't guilty. They knew the other lads weren't guilty. And the establishment wanted to break these two. Desi Warren, you know, got 3 years. He ended up being given a liquid cosh. Ricky didn't soldier when he was in there, and so therefore, when he comes out of prison, when they both came out, the campaign started, and the campaign will go on, and we will not stop until we get that justice. Just on from that, I'd now like to bring in Gary Davis from the London Defence Committee.
Speaker, but I believe in justice, and a gross injustice was bestowed upon these lads, which is a stain on our country. And I'd like to say from start off, I came to Shrewsbury in 1972 from London on a coach with building workers and other trade unions just to show solidarity with our brothers who were brought before the courts. And incidentally, 3 months after the strike, 3 months after the strike, when the police were present on the site and accompanied the pickets, and there were 200 and odd charges laid against these lads. Take North Wales, when the first pickets came before the courts, did you know the courts threw it out? No case to answer. Well, Sir MacAlpine wasn't very pleased with that. There was a big wig in the then Tory government. I believe he was treasurer or chairman. And the lands and the big building industries lobbied. They wanted blood because these men had the audacity to go around to building sites and speak to building workers who weren't members of a trade union movement, but were like these lads who worked with their hands, and explain to them that they were doing wrong by not paying taxes. They were doing wrong by going to work. And if they had an accident and they'd given a fictitious name, their parents couldn't be traced as they were killed. And that's what the strike was about. It was called the Lamp. And I digress a lot because it's a big story here. I'd like to say a big thank you to the people of Shrewsbury for not falling for the massive press campaign before the trial against the lads before they ever got through the court door. They were guilty before they ever walked in that court. How can that be right? I believe in a big thank you to the people of Shrewsbury who didn't fall for that line in court. It went on for about 10 weeks. The biggest trial in British trade union history apart from the 12 Puddle Martyrs, and they were both charged with conspiracy. Conspiracy then in 72, still you could be hung for. That's how vicious it was, 200 and odd charges. It took them 3 months to come up with these charges because obviously the employers wanted revenge. Now, as I say, I came to Shrewsbury for the first time in my life and I couldn't see it. There were police shoulder to shoulder marching up the road on the pavement, and I thought to myself, I was a young electrician and I'm an electrician by trade. And I thought, what's going on here? You know, there's somebody who's been murdered, who's been killed. And when we got to Shrewsbury Court, I witnessed something I've never seen in my life. The police, shoulder to shoulder, hundreds of them, that were marching like that. The only thing missing was the rifle. And I was scared. I felt scared. I thought, this is England. What's going on? What have these men done? So anyway, we went home eventually. And you probably followed it in the Shropshire Star. And I'd like to thank the Shropshire Star and the Morning Star, who were in court. The Morning Star, remember that name. You can always look up the archives. They had a reporter in the courts, day in and day out. Fleet Street never attended. Why? Because they had the men guilty. They wanted the revenge and they were on side of the employers and they were the 12 Puddle Martyrs. They had to put up with all that rubbish as well. And they were rubbished. And they hadn't even formed a union. They were talking about from 9 shillings a week, their wages were reduced to 8 shillings and then to 7 shillings and working from dawn to dusk. And when those men met together to see that their children wouldn't starve, it leaked out to London. That was a conspiracy. They were deported to Australia. Never even formed the union. They talked about supporting each other. And the same thing in this case here. So I followed the case and I'll move on a bit. I got a phone call one day from TNG, union organiser for London, saying that Des Warren was coming to London. And Elsa Warren was coming to London. So I said, yes. They said, well, she's got nowhere to stay. I said, what do you mean she's got nowhere to stay? Who is Elsa Warren? He said, Desi Warren, because the lads had been sentenced. And the interesting thing is about the sentences, it happened Christmas week. Why is that? Because no solidarity action could be taken. And the foreman of the court, they couldn't reach a majority decision. And the judge was really angry about that, and Ricky knows about that. If you ever get a chance to read Ricky's speech, and Des's speech from the dock, please do get hold of a copy of Jim Anderson's book, The Shrewsbury Three, because there is a report of what happened in your town. And you will be amazed. You will be ashamed. And I know you're good people, and you're honest people. And something the British people hold to their hearts, the Irish people and the Scottish people and the Welsh people, is justice. And a great miscarriage of justice has taken place here in our name, and we're not going to put up with it. 44 years later, I'm here. Anyway, I got this phone call. So it said, Desi Warren, you know, I said, Desi Warren, Ricky and Desi have been sent to prison. And she wants to come to London to lobby Parliament. And she's got 5 children. But Jesus Christ, I was living in Brixton, a 2-bedroom flat. I said, I can't put her up. I've only got 2 rooms and I've got 2 kids. You know, I can't sleep those kiddies on the floor. So the third call come back to me, she will not be put up by the TNG in the hotel. She wants to stay with someone like you. So I had a word with my wife, who's a Welsh miner's daughter, and we put them up. And we did that forever and a day. Whenever they came to London, the children stayed with us. But we had to find a fare. 5 children, and I had no money from the TUC. I had me and my conscience. I couldn't sleep. Thinking of those children, thinking I should turn the other cheek. I've done my bit, but I couldn't do it. I couldn't do it. I had to do something, so I formed a committee. And we had 2 TUC resolutions, which are not easily got. You have to argue in the branches. It has to be pushed upstairs. for their release, never implemented. A Labour Party resolution, the Labour Party comes never a march by the TUC, which we forced them to take from Tower Hill, you know where Bloody Tower is, that's where it is, to the Houses of Commons, and still nothing. It's been the biggest campaign ever mounted by the rank and file. I'm not an official, I'm just me. I don't like injustice, and I know you people don't. And I'm very proud of the people of Shrewsbury who couldn't be bludgeoned into putting these lads in prison, who couldn't come to a decision after 10 weeks in the courts, where the case was going backwards or forwards, and the abuse of the judges, turning around in his chair, throwing his pen on the floor, when the defence was speaking, turning his back on him. If you did that in court, you'd get done for contempt. Why wasn't he? He was clearly biased, clearly very, very biased. And it accidentally was told not to come to the conclusion of sending these men to prison. But these lads had a choice, and the choice was quite easy, wasn't it? £50, plead guilty, walk away, and the union will pay for it. Some of the men gave in because they were told they would never see their wives and children again. And they pleaded guilty, and they weren't guilty. And those poor men carry that on their conscience to this day. How did I tell their children they weren't guilty? But you pleaded guilty, Dad, not Ricky and Des. And we owe a great debt to these men who stood up for justice for everybody, for all of us in this room, and every trade unionist and non-trade unionist. They stood up for justice. I think we owe a great debt to Des Warren and Ricky Tomlinson. That's why I'm here today, 44 years later. But I want to go on about the foreman and the jurors from Shrewsbury. They thought it would be an easy touch in Shrewsbury. Tory town, be a pushover. Not so. The Shrewsbury people wouldn't have that. They couldn't come to a majority decision. They came to a majority decision when the foreman was spoken to, the foreman of the jury, by Clark, saying, from the defence, from the prosecution, there wouldn't be a custodial sentence. He went back to the jurors. And equally, the judge had said, if they didn't reach a decision within 24 hours or so, they would be locked in a hotel over Christmas. Now, that's putting pressure on, you know, don't they? You know, undue pressure. And so the juror went back, and there was a split. And an argument with the jurors saying, I don't believe this is true. I don't believe they are not going to send them to prison, although I've been told it will not be a custodial sentence. And I'll end here. That juror turned out to be right. He was lied to. And he took that message back to the jury. And he didn't believe it himself, but he took that message back. That's why the decision was guilty. They were only going to get a £50 fine. And they were lied to. And that's a terrible, terrible thing. The case should be reopened. It should be squashed. All the pickets should be reimbursed for all the pain and suffering of their families and their children to this day, who are still suffering. I went to Shotton with Ricky 5 years ago. And I saw a guy, I recognised him from a photograph. I said, you're one of the pickets. And he turned round, I was shocked. He said, oh, don't tell him I'm here. I said, tell who? Don't tell him I'm here. I said, yes, I am. He said, but I'm still working. And if they find out, I'll lose my job. 30 odd years later, that's the fear. Well, we've got to put it right. And with your support, I must say, I went to a meeting last night to a Victoria area, which I live in now. I moved out of London in Banstead. And I explained to Labour Party AGM what was happening here today. And I explained about the jurors and what happened to his father. And the young juror's son is here tonight. He found his father dead at 48 years of age. His father couldn't sleep after that decision. It cost him his life. He found his father with his six-year-old daughter dead on the floor. And I pay a great tribute to that man. I must find where he's buried and put some flowers in. for all of us. Anyway, I made the case at this Labour Party AGM, and I've got a unanimous decision. They support you all the way, Ricky.
Thank God bless you.
I put an article in the Index and Reader a couple of months ago now, and I had a bloke phone me up. I think he was around about 85, he was getting on in years, and he said to me, "I'd like to tell you a little story about what happened to me when the pickets were on trial in Shrewsbury." He said, when the police were surrounding the courts, and there was a good few hundred of them that were there, and don't forget, this is a building where there's a trial, and you know, there's about 800 to 1,000 police around the whole of the court. He said he walked up to where the court was, and amongst the police ranks, he recognised a face, and he thought, he walked up to this lad, and he said, and it was his cousin, and he said to him, "I thought you were in the army." He said, "I am." He said, "But they've got me out here doing this," and that is a true story that came from a fellow from Wrexham, who was a building worker in Wrexham. After our next speaker, we'd like to open the floor up to questions and answers. So without more ado, I don't think I have to introduce him, but I will. Ricky Tomlinson.
Before I start, I want to apologise if I sort of get a bit angry or a bit emotional. But I want to thank the lads from London. They've been there for 40 odd years. And I must tell you now, there's a difference between the 24
and the Shrewsbury 2. The 24 have done a magnificent job. The researcher has done an amazing job, and she's got all them documents. But they're playing by the rules. They're doing what the CCRC, the Criminal Case Review Committee, want them to do. And I don't give a shit if my name gets cleared, because it doesn't matter. Because the six of the pickets have already died. So what good is it going to do them? I don't care if they squash it or quash it or do what you want, because we've been doing this. We've been doing this since 2012. And when it goes to the CCR, you get a commissioner. Well, we've had three, and we're now on our fourth commissioner. They're just pushing us into the long grass. And so we've now become the Shrewsbury 2, because I intend to go active after Christmas. I'm going to the CCR, I'm going to Downing Street. I will probably get locked up again, because I'm in my 78th year. And what are they going to do to me? Put me back in jail? I want justice now. Some of the things these lads have said, they've only just touched on the tip of the iceberg. Mm. What happened to us was disgraceful. We went on strike, as he said, the one and only ever building strike. And I was working on the Wrexham bypass. I was just council, but living in North Wales. Living in a little council house with my wife and two small boys. And we joined the strike. The strike was going, we joined the strike. And the Welsh lads asked me if I'd be the mouthpiece, the Wrexham and the Welsh lads. And I said, of course I will. And I went to every single meeting. And now and again, I would vote against whatever was proposed. And one thing I used to vote against all the time was, some firms agreed to pay the rate, because we were after £30 for a 35-hour week of better health and safety. Some firms said, well, we'll pay £30 a week to our workers, and if they send £1 a week each into the strike fund, will you let them work? And I was voted down. I said, no, the trade union rules are, one out, we're all out. One back, we all go back. And I used to get voted down. I believe I was right then, and I believe I was right now. But anyway, we went on strike. It was an amazing experience. We've done the Shrewsbury business, as you know. But what Gary didn't know is, or what Gary doesn't know is, the Shropshire Star weren't on our side. The Shropshire Star weren't on our side. They were our enemy. They supplied the police with a set of photographs to be shown during the trial, and they showed them in the reverse order. And when our barristers pointed this out, he said, they're in the wrong order. Them lads are not running wild, they're walking back to the bus. Oh, he said it doesn't matter. That's what was going on. And we've got documents that the reporters and the photographers from the Shropshire Star knew what sites we were going to before I did. We've got their police statements saying we got a call at 1:30. Now, I'd hired a coach. I'd hired a coach to go because I lived in Wrexham and we were going to Oxford Street. We were supposed to be terminating at Oxford Street. And I'd hired a coach of Chequin Price in Wrexham, and he used his coaches for the school run. And when we got to Oxford Street, he said, listen, we've had an SOS call. Can we go further afield to Telford? So I had to go on the phone to him and say, Chequin, look, I'm not going to be back for 1 o'clock. Can I keep the coach till 5? And he went, okay, that's fine. So I didn't know where we were going. But they didn't say that when they charged us with conspiracy. And what we also forgot to mention is that although there were 6 or 7 coaches of us, there was a coach with 80 policemen on it. There was 80 policemen on it. And at the end, and we've got the photograph to prove it, that they're standing with their hands in the pockets or arms folded. They never made an arrest. They never charged anyone. They never cautioned anyone and never took a name and address. In fact, we got congratulated by the Chief Inspector Meredith. He shook hands with us as we got on the coaches and then we went home. 15 weeks later, I'm working on the Wrexham bypass and they come to see us. He said, listen, we know your family background and we'd like you to be a prosecution witness. I said, how can I be a prosecution witness? I was in charge here. Nothing happened unless I give the okay. I gave the money out for petrol. I gave the money out for fish and chips. I went to all the meetings, come back and reported to the lads. I said, how can I? He said, well, if you're not, we'll prosecute you. And that's exactly what they did, what Gary said. 271 charges. 27 against Des Warren and 21 against me. But what they done, they put conspiracy on it. Now, what the word conspiracy means is, if you go outside here now, you've got a bottle and you throw it through someone's window, you might be entitled to a month in jail or whatever. But if they charge you with conspiring to pick that bottle up and throw it through the window, the sentence is indeterminate. They can give you what they want. So that's what you do. Now, Mackie Jones got 9 months. Mackie Jones wasn't at the meeting where the conspiracy was supposed to have taken place. He was the treasurer. He'd been in and took all the money from steelworks and the miners and whatever. He got it all, signed for this all, and he'd gone home. He wasn't in the building. He wasn't at the meeting, but they still charged him with conspiracy. So there's all sorts gone on. But I'm going to jump about here, and I might have to go back to things. But what I have found out is that one of the 6 in the dock was a fucking informer, a police informer. And then it turns out when I challenged one of our legal bodies, I said, one of them was an informer. He said, no, there was 2. There was 2. And a nation provocateur. So any of this mayhem that went on, nothing to do with the pickets, and we didn't know at the time, obviously. There was a nation provocateur amongst us. Amongst us. But anyway, we got charged, as I say, we went on trial and they got the 6 of us in a whole, what they call a holding cell. And 2 barristers, John Blatchmills and David Turner Samuels, come down to see us. And he said, listen, if you plead guilty now, it's 10 o'clock now. If you plead guilty, you'll be home for dinner time. You're getting fined 50 quid, as Gary said, and the union are going to pay the £50. And the first 4 lads took the deal. And they come to me and he said, how about you? I said, I'm not taking it. I said, well, that's what I'm not taking it. I said, I've got no record. I've got 3 brothers. My mum and dad live in Liverpool. Never been in trouble in our lives. Never had the police to the door. And Jesse said, no, I'm not pleading guilty. And give the other 4 their due. They didn't plead guilty, then they changed. But you know what Gary was saying about the police? Look at that. Look at that. I want you to come and have a look at all this after. The Cray twins never got that sort of protection. The IRA bombers never got that. Look at that. Because the 6 building workers on trial, there wasn't hundreds, as he said, on duty. There was thousands. They were secreted under the courtroom. They were on motorbikes and in vans. And outside Shrewsbury, there's a monument. I think it's Nelson or someone like that. There was a fella up there with a video camera, a copper, with a video camera, videoing us.
And as I walked up the steps, I was late getting here. I walked up to the steps, it was about 2 minutes to 10. The policeman said to me, "Oh, sorry, you can't go in." Oh, I said, "That was really me, thanks for your thanks a lot for that. Anyway, he let us in, and then, as I say, the shillard after. The trial lasted 55 working days, and cost today's money between 12 and 15 million pounds. £50 million to get a couple of bill workers locked up. But it wasn't that they were doing, they were setting a precedent. The Lord he charged us with had never been used. It was written in 1875, and it was called the Protection of Property Act. Never been used, so used it. Now, since he put us in jail, they've scrapped it. They've scrapped it, but there was all sorts of Tom. And I say, if I go on all night, I get quite angry. But what I really get angry about is what he done to Desi Warren. I was a soldier. He wasn't a soldier. So I'd never been jailed before. The first prison we went to, we went to what he called a block, was the confinement. He was over that side, I was this side. He said, "Oh, get out. You bring your bed out, take your chair out, and throw up the water on the floor. So you've got to stand all day at step, sit on the floor in the water. Now, am I telling you the truth, or am I making it up?" And as I say, we'll have Q&A, ask it. You can ask me whatever you want. So we went on the blanket, then we wear clothes, we wouldn't do it. So they moved us to a women's prison to see if that wiped us down. And it didn't, because Desi discovered that the screws had a black market business going on from bicycles and sell them or whatever it was, something like that. So they moved us back to Rose prison. And then altogether I was 14 prisons, and Desi was in 17.
Wow.
You come at midnight to yourself, say, put your stuff in your pillowcase and you'd move you. You couldn't tell your family where you were going or what you were doing. We were in one cell in London, we were going to the appeal court. You put us in with a young man. He had photographs of his wife all over the wall, and all of a sudden, just like that, red blade up his wrist. Blood everywhere. I dived on him as he rang the bell. The screws come, dragged his pole out. He was doing 3 years. And it took him about half an hour later, he come back. His wife's a ghost with his arm open and stuff, and he rolled the board outside the cell, scratched his wrist. He didn't like to do himself in. Some of the stuff that went on was unbelievable. Some of the bribes that gave us was dreadful. But they did let me and Desi up. Now, the reason for this, I used to take piss out of them. He'd come in and swear at me, and I'd go, "Woo, officer, don't swear. Does your wife know you swear like that?" But Desi go, "Good." And I used to take the bait. Desi used to take the bait, so they give him a terrible time. They give him a dog's life. They made him wear pin shoes, but he used to have specially built insoles in his shoes then. He took his glasses off him, so he could hardly see underneath the paper. One time his wife went to visit him with the 5 kids. They left the kids outside the prison, took her in. Trying to break him down. But what we didn't know at the time was, we're giving him the liquid cosh and the needle. And of course I didn't know about it. I tried it once, they give me that. He gives you the 100-yard stare, you're like, "On me." And a lot of lads take it, they just want to sleep their time away. You just want to get on the bunk, sleep their time away. One side side at Navit. Desi suffered for it. So I'm going to show you the photograph. This is me, Desi, 1972. Two young men. And by the way, I didn't know him. I didn't know Desi. I only met him during the strike. And of the 6 in the dock, some of them had never met. And I'm charged with conspiracy with them. Didn't know them. So there's me and Desi. And there's the last time I've seen Desi, with Arthur Scargill. He's strapped into a wheelchair. He couldn't stand up. He couldn't lift his head up. He was strapped. 3 straps round his body, round the wheelchair. That's him. So that's what they've done, and they've got no conscience about it. But he paid him compensation. But he had to sign a gagging clause. But as I say, we were in. I'd done 18 months, so I think I had another 6 months or something to do. And I've been moved to Leicester, and that's when my politics changed. Because the governor of Leicester was an ex-bricklayer. He would have to pack up the building again because his hands were crippled with arthritis. And he said to me, he gave me a book, he said, "Have you read that?" I said, he was a lovely man, I said, I haven't known what is it. He said, "It's called The Ragged Trousered Philanthropist."
Oh, yes.
And I read it, it changed my life, changed my politics.
Yeah.
There and then, I couldn't stop reading it. And I had a lot of respect for this governor. And he came to me one day and he went, "You've got a visit tomorrow, Rick." I said, "I don't have visits, I don't wear clothes." He used to shit on the floor. wouldn't go to the lavatory. I never pressed the bell. The whole of the time I was in prison, I never pressed that bell on the wall because I wanted nothing off them. I never, ever shut my own cell door. They used to shout, shut your door. I used to shout, fuck off, you shut it.
Yeah.
I shouldn't be in here. So he took me to the governor's. He said, it's important, Rick. You've got a meeting in my office tomorrow. I said, you don't have visits in the governor's office. So the next day, I put a pair of shorts on and went up to his office. And there was three blokes in there. One called Billy Jones, a joiner. I knew he was from Kirby. Another joiner called Alan Abrams, who was from the Whittle, who we knew. And there was an MP from Birmingham called Tom Litterick. And he said, we want you to go home. I said, what? We want you to go home. I said, I didn't want to be here in the first place. But I'm not going. He said, oh, you've got to. I said, I'm not going to sit in there. I said, I'm going. I said, I've seen my wife. Had a wonderful friend of ours, Billy Baines. I'll never be able to pay him the way he left in my family. But he goes short of nothing. He's there. He brings them to the prison. He's lovely. I've got no seen there. I'm going to do time out. He said, you aren't. What do you mean about? He said, Desi is so ill. He's so ill. We're frightened he might make it. I said, you're winding me. But we're not winding you up. And the thing is, you'll have to write to him and tell him you're going home. But can't tell him why. But I can't tell him why. I said, we've made a pact. He said, I'm asking you, he's ill. He's ill. If you do your full 2 years, you know what he'll do his full 3 years. So I had to go back to myself and write a letter. Before I left the governor's office, picked the phone up. Now, who did he from? I don't know. But he said, Tomlinson's read. He said, he'll go. He wants 48 hours, then he's going to go. That was it. Who was he talking to? Who was the governor's? Who was he speaking to? Anyway, cut the story short. I went, I wrote a letter to Desi, and I had to say, Desi, I'm missing this, we're missing this, we're missing this, blah, blah, blah. We've had to go, come on. And he wrote me a terrible letter. A terrible letter. He said, what a cowardly bastard you are. What a coward. We made a pact. And I couldn't tell him. And when I got out of prison, I went out in the country, obviously drawing attention to his plight in jail. I couldn't go and see him because there was stuff going on in his personal life that I couldn't tell him if he asked me. Couldn't tell him. It was awful, heartbreaking. Just give you one example. I went to his house to see him, and he had a little cottage in a place called Heaven. And in the window, in one of them little windows, was a notice for sale. He's in jail, he's in solitary confinement. I said, Elsa, what is? You sell him the cottage? She said, yeah. I said, well, what happens when Elsa comes out? She said, we'll get a camera on that field. How could I go and sell him that? How could I go and tell him that? So I never spoke to him, never got in touch with him. Ran the country, got thrown at the TUC conference in Blackpool, made the 6 o'clock news, all the headlines, blah, blah, blah. There I am getting thrown out, screaming from the balcony. Marie Patterson was the chairperson. She said, if you don't move yourself, I'll call the police. And the lads were booing and saying, I only wanted to speak for 5 minutes. Anyway, the bouncers come and lash me out. Never spoke to Desi, never spoke to him for years. And then, one day, I got a letter under my door and just said, Desi would love to see you. This was years later. And I went to his house at the address in Chester, and I knocked on the door, and a woman's voice shouted, come in. And I went in, and I went into the living room, and he was lying on a mattress on the floor with a rope from the mattress into the beams, into the joist in the ceiling. And he pulled himself up, and he put his arms around me, and he kissed me. And he said, do you know how long it is? I said, I haven't got a clue. He said, it's so many years and so many months and so many days. And he was awful. He was awful. He was like that. Snow white hair. He was a steel fixer by trade. He looked like a skeleton. He never worked again. And he got persecuted by the newspapers. And his kids had a rough time. And it was awful. It was absolutely awful. And so I said to him, well, he didn't have to say it. He knows I'm not giving this up. He knows I'm not giving it up, not only to clear our name, but for him. I don't know how much money they gave him in compensation for the treatments he got in prison. But it must be wicked when he's had to sign a gagging clause. cacking floors. So, as I say, we don't know to Shrewsbury too. I owe it to him, and I don't care what it takes. I'm in my 78th year. I will use every last day I've got. Not necessarily to clear our name, I'm not bothered, but to expose the establishment for what they've done. Now, what I've done here, I've brought some, I mean, there must be Eileen Turnbull, our researcher, done an incredible job. I can't knock her. She's done an incredible job, and she's got a million secret documents. I've only got half a dozen. But she's playing by the rules. She's letting the CCRC dictate. I'm not bothered whether they clear my name. It doesn't matter. The pain's been there. We've had the hurt. We've had the slights. We've had all that. And you know, when scabs say to me, oh, it was disgraceful what you've done and all like that. It was terrible. I say, you know, someone died every day in the building game. Every single day, there was a widow and orphans. Every day, every working day, without fail, someone got killed. And the most the boss could be done was £100 fine. Nowhere to go to the toilet. If there was a tree or a shrub or whatever, where if you're out on, like me, on a bypass, you got a cement bag and went where you could and hide yourself and do whatever you had to do. Or go home and lose your wages. And if you were lucky enough to find somewhere to go, there was nowhere for you to wash your hands. Nowhere for you to have a cup of tea. But they always managed to get hot water and flush toilets in the offices for the bosses. So if they can do it for the bosses, how come they can't do it for the workers? What they done was horrendous. And it's got to be exposed. The judge was a lunatic. He wasn't. He was what they call an ecclesiastical barrister. He'd never done a high-profile criminal case. Never done one. Didn't have a clue. He used to have John Platt-Mills or David Turner Samuels. Or what happens here, what the tip me. They were telling him what to do. And then, of course, the jury stuff. 8-4 he was split. 8-4. This is after 55 days. And he said to him, go to a hotel and carry on discussing, carry on deliberating. That's illegal. That's illegal. The only place they can discuss the case is in the jury room. So the next day they come back, and within 15 minutes, two of them had changed their mind. And they'd been told exactly what we were told on day one. What's all the problem? If they get found guilty, they're only getting fined £50 and the union are paying the £50. Now his dad was either the foreman of the jury or the deputy foreman. And when I got me 2 years, because we read speeches, me and Desi both read speeches from the dock, when I got 2 years on each count, his dad jumped up with the other fellow and started physically fighting with other members of the jury. They got up and run out, locked themselves in the jury room. And the judge had to send for them because Desi hadn't been sentenced yet. And he's got to be there, so they had to come out and sit down, and he was upset, and we could tell he was upset. And then Desi got 3 threes. 3 years on each of the 3 charges. So what do you say? This is bad to go. But as I say, they couldn't have chose 2 worse fellas to put in jail. They couldn't have chose 2 worse fellas. I would have been there for the rest of my life before I get in. Because I hated them. I hated what they'd done. As I say, I want you to come and have a look at these documents. I want you to take them away if you want. These are just the tip of the iceberg. We have them from Ted Heath, Woodrow Wyatt, the Attorney General, the Home Secretary. And what she did find out, the researcher, the most we could have got, she found an article by a Canadian law professor called Lawrence Lusgarten, who teaches law at Oxford. And she found an article from him in the Law Journal, and it said the most that these lads could have got was 3 months. Now I've got 2 years, then he's got 3 years. 3 months was the most. And someone must have spotted it and give it to the Home Secretary. And she's got his reply. Oh my God, they're doing years and they've only got 3 months. So we sent it to the Attorney General. She's got the reply from the Attorney General. And the reply is this. Oh, you're right. He should have only got 3 months. But their defence team have missed it, so leave them where they are. So they left us in jail. So after 5 months, he let us out while we went to appeal. When we went back after 5 months, instead of the case being heard by Lord Justice Salmon, who's sitting in the big chair? The Lord Chief Justice, Widgery. And he listened to the case, and he squashed 2 of the 3 charges. And he said, he said to our barristers, would you like to appeal the sentences? And they said no. They said no. So we went back to jail to finish our time. Now, later on, we got a letter or a document from David Altaris, who was my junior. And in it, he said, the most these lads could have got was 3 months. Why didn't he speak up when he was at the appeal court? Why didn't he speak up? It's absolutely unbelievable. But just a couple of little things that come out during the time, and we'll get off and open the open floor. He had death threats, and quite a lot went on. In fact, I think he moved his wife and his kids. But as I say, look, Shrewsbury's got a bit of a bad name, really. Anyone in the trade union movement, if you mention Shrewsbury, you went, whoa, 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 whoa. And that's not fair, really. That's not fair. I think the people of Shrewsbury were great. I think they were absolutely lovely. But we knew we wouldn't get a fair crack at the whipping Shrewsbury. So we asked for the trial to be moved. And they actually went to Birmingham, the barristers and whatever, and they said, no, it's got to be held in Shrewsbury. Now, that couldn't happen that day. But before, I'm just finished about 2 minutes because I'm doing a Q&A. But what I want you to do here is look at some of these documents, take away everyone. But one here, I don't know where it's in, so I'll have it. It's from Amnesty International. Amnesty International. That's an organisation set up for political prisoners, or POCs, they call them.
So that's a conscience.
While I was in, and Desi was in, they applied for us to be made political prisoners or prisoners of conscience. So they would get so worried about Desi at the time, he knew he could go on unless I went. He shoved me out. As I say, he ran whoever it was, Denny Street or whoever. He sent him out. The next day, Desi was granted political prisoner status the following day. 3 months later, 2 people from the Labour Party, Dave Reynolds and someone I've got the documents today, got in touch with Amnesty International, and Desi Warren was deselected. He was knocked off political prisoner status. Never been happened before. It's never happened. So we went down there not long ago, and we had a demonstration outside. T-shirts on and all like that, the lawyers with us, mother. And the fellow called, he went, look, I am sorry, I'm so embarrassed. He said, this can happen today. What happened could never happen again. We were leaned on by these people. Alex Lyons, right up there in the Labour Party. Yeah, I could understand it, come up in the Conservative Party, but for the Labour Party, they're not political prisoners. They're political prisoners. And just to digress slightly, I've got it, you can have a look at this if any of you lads are in the building game. This is an original copy of the Economic League blacklist. We've got this, I can't tell you where it comes from, but the names here, there are thousands upon thousands upon thousands. It's got your trade, your address, your national insurance number. It's got a lot. And a young lady's come forward who said she worked in their offices. And if anyone phoned up about me, she said it was red flagged. If Desi, it was red flagged. But why the difference is, I don't know. When my name was mentioned for the job or whatever, mine was red flagged, and then a copy was sent to MI5 and a copy was sent to the special branch. So a fella said, come on. Now, I've actually met the MI, not physically, but via the video screen. I've met the MI5 man who was seconded to look at me and to infiltrate me and do whatever. And his name is Tony Robinson, the same as the lad off the television. And he's speaking on the screen saying, yes, he was a political thug. And he just said, well, hang on, political thug, back it up. Never said a word. Because at that time, dirty tricks abounded. Now, Peter Hayne, who's been a bit of a shit, actually, I've looked at Peter Hayne. He doesn't want to get involved in the campaign. But I remember Peter Hayne getting charged with armed robbery for robbing a bank. Do you remember?
Yeah.
Peter Hayne got charged with armed robbery because he was leading the anti-apartheid movement. He'd come over from South Africa and he'd done a tremendous job. And someone, they got someone, a lookalike, dressed him the same, sent him into a bank with a gun, and, well, they gave him the money. And how he'd have got done? They charged him. They charged him, only he'd have got done. Only a little lad he run past in the street. He said, that wasn't him. It wasn't him. It was someone else. And that's how he got off with it. But that's what they can do to you. They can do anything. My telephone is still tapped. It's been hacked by Murdoch's crowd. That doesn't.
Oh, yeah.
They can do what they want, and they can get away with it. There's no recourse, I'm telling you. There will be someone in here tonight, and I'm not pointing fingers. Mm. There will be someone in here tonight who's not on our side. Mm. I'm telling you that for nothing. As I say, I thought there was one informer in this guy. And as I get told, no, there was two. And also, an Asian provocateur. But also, I want you to read them. There's one document there I want you to read in particular. We started, the second time we started our appeal to get the papers released was in 2012, early 2012. And there's a letter there which says, in November 2012, to the minister, the Justice Minister, get the papers to the secret office and shred them. How can you shred something when we're appealing and we need to see them? They're there. I want you to have a look. But as I say, we've got them from Ted Heath, the Attorney General, the Home Secretary, MPs Woodrow Wyatt. But before I go, Phil and I, we had a load of DVDs made. I'll give a couple out tonight. About three or four, that's all I can give away. Because we've got to take these lads and take some back to London. Now on it, Boris Strait, the man who prosecuted us, not only wrote to me years ago, he wrote me a three-page letter. Now, unfortunately, we've lost a page, but there's two pages. And in it he said, Rick, I would much rather have had a pint with you than send you to jail.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's from Morris Drake. That's how deep this goes. It's unbelievable. They can do what they want. There's so much to say. But Morris Drake, I phoned him when he was about 88 years of age, maybe 85. And I phoned him, it's on videotape, his voice is as clear as a bell, and I'm sitting in a little office in my own home. And I said, Mr. Drake, it's Ricky Tomlinson. And he went, hello, how are you doing? I said, okay. I said, look, can you do me a favour? Just clear one little point up for me. He said, what is it? I said, on the day that the jury was out, the very, very last day the jury was out, I said, Jim Arneson, newspaper reporter, walked past your desk in the lunch break and seen on it one of them little yellow stickers, and on it was a message, and it said, inform the judge, whatever the verdict, not to jail these men. I said, is that true? You got a message from the government. And he said, no. It was a phone call. It was a phone call. He said, and my junior, a man called Desmond Fennell, went on to be a bigwig in the legal profession. Desmond Fennell took the note. And that's right, he said, that's what it said. Inform the judge, whatever the verdict, do not jail these men. And I said, well, what did you do? He said, I withheld it from the judge. And that's why we went to jail. So, anyone who thinks there was no political interference in Shrewsbury is living in cloud cuckoo. But the fight goes on. Now, first of all, before I sit down, I want to thank you for turning out tonight. I'm absolutely delighted. I'm absolutely, because everyone here obviously might agree with me, and that doesn't matter. You've heard my version. Now it's up to you. 10 minutes, 15 minutes Q&A, is that okay?
Yeah.
God bless you, and thank you for listening.
Thank you.
absolutely amazing.
Just quickly, on the subject of the photographs that Ricky talks about, Maurice Drake, the prosecution counsel, he's actually said to the court that these pickets were like a gang of marauding Indians running across the site. Now, the photographs that Ricky talks about, does that look like a gang of marauding Indians? And every photograph is like that. I was told only yesterday or the day before by one of the pickets who remembered it. He remembered it as I was talking to him, and as you do, you start to remember things. And this picket is about, I think he's 83 now.
81.
And quite often it's come up that when you see a photograph like that, you see them carrying sticks or leaning on sticks like that. But not a gang of marauding Indians. They're just walking up the side. What they were actually doing, I found out, they were actually walking off the site. They'd done the site meeting, they'd done the tour, they were starting to come off the site when somebody said, look out, here's the anti-picket squad coming. And so what they did to defend themselves, to be fair, they picked up sticks. But when they got just slightly further up the hill, they realised it wasn't an anti-picket squad, it was Desi Warren with another crowd of the pickets coming. He'd finished his talk on the site, and he was coming off the site with the other pickets, so they all met up, and he walked off the site. Now, that's the corruption that went on. I don't know if I can just say about the attacks on Marlene.
No, that's all it was. I want people to come and see these documents, because they're all stamped secret, top secret, confidential, not to be seen. It's important you see them.
He wrote an autobiography at the end of August. And in that autobiography, the trial of the Shrewsbury pits is the only case I know of where the government ordered the prosecution in defiance of the advice of senior police and prosecution authorities. Now, that's come from a QC who was involved in the trial, wrote an autobiography, was a top QC, and to me, that says it all. Thank you.
Any questions at all? Young lad there,
Tom, just from Ellesmere Port. You know what you're saying, you're going to focus on the campaign next year. I'm a member of a chair of our local community branch of the trade for Unite, also the vice chair of our DLP, you know, in Ellesmere Port. Is there any kind of model motion you want put through to try and put pressure on the MP?
I don't understand that motion. It's the only motion I've got here. If you feel organic, I'll tell you all about that.
Fantastic. By all means, I'll do that.
God bless you. Thank you. Party.
Bit of best.
Can I just clarify one point?
Yeah.
It seems that during the actual dispute, nobody was arrested on the picket lines. Mm. Or picked up by the police, or cautioned, or charged.
No.
And you're saying it was 3 months later that they said?
Yeah.
Incredible.
I was asked to be a prosecution witness because of my family background in the Conservatives, believe it or not. And listen, I've just mentioned something there. My grandparents, great-grandparents, were Conservatives. I've got a programme out in the next few days called Who Do You Think You Are?
Yes, they come from the workhouse.
They were in the warehouse, 24 families in a what they called a court, with one toilet between them and one cold water standby, and they were Conservatives. Because of religion. Because it was religion. I've watched them, I don't want to spoil the programme for you, but there was like, things were so bad that when my granddad got crushed to death on the dock, they opened him up and took his body parts out, which was illegal. I mean, I won't spoil it for you, but I get emotional in that. But listen, I'm past myself by date now, but I will do what I've got to do here until I snuff it. I was lucky though, see, I've got a job. I've been all over the world. I've met Robert De Niro, Samuel Jackson. I've had a little dance with Lauren McCall. Some of the lads haven't worked again.
Yeah.
A couple of them are dead. One's 91. Ken O'Shea has got serious dementia. You know what I mean?
I'm not bothered about me. I really am not bothered about me anymore. But I am about them. There's got to be some sort of justice for them. And for
Mr.
Them.
Tomlinson.
Pardon? Mr. Tomlinson. You can stand up, please, sir. If you will.
I think I'm probably the odd one out here. But I was on a site that day, visited by supporters of UCAN.
Yeah.
And despite your colleague next year, who throws cold water on the fact how they behave, I think over the years I've described how they came on the site, and that was exactly how I described it. They were like Indians coming down to us. Now, I don't know the ins and outs of the charges that were levelled against you. I'll be honest, I always thought that the police were out to get you. Not you personally, but whoever was in it being led, doing the leading. But I was certainly herded into a canteen that was on site, and we were continually threatened by the blokes.
Why were you working, you don't mind me asking you?
I was an electrician. I was a member
of
that.
Why were you working?
Why was I working?
Yeah. It was a national strike.
By UCAN.
But not by the building industry.
My union never called me out.
Eh?
My union never called me out. I'm a member of, was a member of...
Were you not? Gary?
Frank Chappell withdrew us from the building federation.
Well, Frank Chappell, you're the leader of your union.
Yes.
It was him that stopped me from speaking at the TUC conference.
I don't speak for Chappell. I'm just saying what happened on the day that, and I was there. And it wasn't all clean fun.
No, we never said that. You know,
if you're talking about conspiracy, that's something I didn't experience. Nothing to do with it. But when you talk about people that on your side of the table that had emotional problems after the event,
yeah,
it existed amongst those who were threatened on that day.
Yeah, but
I was.
I take your point.
Well,
I take your point.
One other thing, you
yeah,
they don't like the look of the sound, but Des Warren,
yeah,
this opening gambit it was. We're not here to ask you to go on strike. Big sigh of relief in the camp. I'm even telling you to go on strike. There was a superintendent, Brooks was his name,
yeah,
stood at the door, said, Des Warren, that's a threat. You cannot say that. To Des Warren's extras were, F off. And believe it or not, he went. And the rest of us thought.
Well, why was he arrested?
Hang on. I'm election. Policeman. You lot, who knows? You know, I don't know. I do sympathise with the fact that it probably...
But do you think the sentence is right? 3 years and 2 years?
Well, if I'm totally honest, I can't remember what the charges were.
Conspiracy?
Well, if you did conspire...
Sit down.
Listen,
I don't know.
I didn't know the
lads. They're too young, a lot of them.
I didn't know the lads in the top, in them chairs. But I'm
no, I don't know.
But how come? Now tell me this.
I'm just saying.
More than there's people here. 80 policemen, stand up, because I'm out of your dog on you, Dave.
Well, they're going to shoot me in a
minute. No, shoot Des Warren.
Now, don't take that literally.
Listen, he pulled a gun on Des Warren. The lads took the gun off the fella and took him to the station. They're going to charge him with robbery. That's what happened. So you can tell me, there's 80 policemen, and they don't see anything that they would say, you're nicked or you're nicked.
No, I agree with you. I think that they were out to get you.
Yeah,
no, for what reason? I don't know.
Yeah. Can I just tell you this? You know how they got the witnesses against us?
I was one of you. One of them.
Did you talk?
Who did?
You were a witness against them?
I was witness against him.
You disgust me.
You
like
to be silly,
you don't. Tell me not to be silly, what are you doing
court?
Here?
I end up in court, yes.
Given evidence against us.
Exactly.
Well, interesting.
Yeah. The police.
And you were in a cab as well.
He said that before, didn't he? It's 1 year.
No, he said that you said. No.
I am.
The man's entity. The man's entity. No, he's right on his brakes. Yes. The police went into a hospital in Clandino, 25 police detectives. And scanned the area and took 900 shipments and went it down to 200, out of which 80 of them the policemen. And they came and gave evidence against us.
Did you say I'm a policeman then?
Possibly.
You could be one of the 120.
I tell you how I came back. The site where I was working was visited by the police. And we were asked to, because we weren't very happy with it.
The police were not demoted by the government signals.
Well, we don't know that.
You do now.
We had a terrible time on that day. Blokes threatened by other.
Well, hang on, what about the people that died every day on the boat? Do you feel bad for them?
Look, I was a shop steward at ETU. I'm happy with unionism.
Well, hang on, you know what? One died on the site. The most employer could be fined was 100 quid. That was the price for building work.
Again,
and also, I'm going to just tell you this. Every scab I've met, there were scabs, by the way. There were scabs.
Are you calling me a scab?
He sounds like
a scab. You'd have to come out. He just said, let's just have to come out.
Top, my union, we were not...
Yeah, that's fair enough. I'll accept that. But every scab I know who worked took the rise.
Exactly.
They took the rise and they took the better conditions. You know what I mean?
I was poorly paid, know that.
Yeah, and they still are, by the way.
Yeah.
They still are for what they do. They build houses they'll never be able to live in. They build houses they will never be able to live in. They won't build social housing if there's no profit in it for the bosses. So they build mansions, £1 million and £1.5 million.
No, Mr. Thomas, I'm not here to argue anything.
No, I'm not.
My reason for being here is to hear your side that day.
Yeah.
I agree with, I think that it was a conspiracy, but I ain't got a clue for sure. But do you feel that you were guilty of any crime that day?
No. I was with the police all day.
Well, I don't know. I Des Warren was there.
Yeah.
I don't know whether you were.
Of course I was there. I was there. I was in charge of.
So 60. You were stood in this cabin with me?
No. We were on different sides. And what we used to do, you know, was call the lads together and have a, and they used to take a vote. They used to take a vote. But you know what? I seen a fella, I think it's on the DVD, we're going to give a few out. One fella said, and someone's been killed, and someone's been this. Now, what we've got a photograph, a fella called Grocott.
Yeah, no, I remember.
It's supposed to have been, back, it's on the head with a brick. Okay. Taken to hospital, and under observation for 9 days. I've had a four-way bypass. I was in and out in 4 days. He's on observation. Alleged concussion, he said. What they forget to tell you is, the doctor who examined him, a female doctor, said there's nothing wrong with you. And what did the police do? They went and got another doctor. So he's photographed in bed, like this, getting paid off McAlpine, who he didn't work for, he was a lumper. He got a free holiday, and do you know where he died? Well, injured, sorry. He was working on a McAlpine site later on an open cast coalfield, and got run over by heavy plants. Now, I'd done a documentary, which we're going to give a few away, and I went to see him, he wouldn't shake hands with me while the cameras were on. As soon as the cameras stopped rolling, he shook hands with me and wished me all the best. His name was Grocott.
I remember him.
Yeah, do you know what his nickname was, by the way?
No.
Growler.
No.
His name was Growler because he got on with nobody.
I'm not sick. I applaud you for coming, sir.
I've got nothing but respect
but
for you.
I want to hear your side.
God bless you. Thank you very much. Cheers.
15 policemen gave statements that day in court. 15. Not one of them seen anything untoward on the site. That's what it says, and that's what's in the book, that's what's recorded. You can go to the working class library in Salford, you can pick out all the manuscripts, you can read the transcripts of the courts, and anyone can go there and anyone can look at them.
Anyone
want
to question
people?
Anyone want to
look at
the young man there?
Yeah. Well, I heard more about this issue when I went to Chester. I looked at the May Day speeches, and I forget who gave the May Day speech. But I was there's a deeper issue. You suffer greatly against the authority, going to jail, and and not being able to work. But also that the way that you say that they can do anything, they can tap your phones, and that they can make your life a misery by control behind the scenes. And one of the things that that really shocked me, although it really shouldn't, living in this society, was the story that that person who was part of the Shrewsbury 24, speaking in Chester, told about the effect on his life following the 70s and his involvement. Yeah. He had to go to an interview to be able to go to the United States, for example, because the United States will not... Terry, it was Terry,
well,
that's it, thanks for
this.
That.
Let me tell you this. Here's what the Secret Service here can do, and what they did do. They opened a bank account in Harold Wilson's name. Slaggy deals from somewhere in Wigan. That's what they can do. Mm. So they can tap my phone, they can tap anyone's bloody phone. Yeah. They can do what they want, lad.
So the blacklist is beyond even just that blacklist. It's so deep.
Of course we're letting them do it, but what's the alternative?
If we all I changed the subject to the Susan Cole.
Yeah.
And the first thing I was told was, if every working person has come, she said, I'm just going to work for what? Yes.
Listen, if we wouldn't get them all out to support the miners in 1926, or the last one, you're not going to get them all out.
But what I'm saying is, you stay away to do what you want.
Yeah.
They can only do what you want to do it.
Yes.
Well, I wish I knew what makes the stuff.
Any more questions?
Can I just say, see these pictures here? When the prosecution brought the witnesses into the witness box, they were shown a photograph outside.
Oh, yeah.
Jess Warren and Ricky Tomlinson. Yeah. And when he got to the witness box, the judge would, the prosecution would say, have you seen this man before? Now, this happened in a British court. And they said, yes. He's over there. When we're shown the photographs, I recognise him. Have you seen this man before? They've never seen Ricky before. You've never seen Daddy before.
Did you know all the original statements were lost by the police. So they called everyone back in, give them my photograph and Desi's photograph, and made them make more statements. Now come on, sir, that can't be justice. That cannot be justice. They don't deny it either. They don't deny it. They were given my... And another thing, in the trial, I've never been in a Crown Court before. I've got three brothers and two of them at the open of the trial, at the open of death. David, the big lad, 6 foot off, and Ronnie. And they're sitting in the public gallery waiting for the trial start, and a policeman come and said, you two, out, come home. Up and down into a room downstairs, he went and said, what are you doing here? Nobody said, well, my brother's outside, we've come to see... come on, what are you really here for? He said, that's what we're there here for. We've come to see my brother, it's Ricky Tomlinson. He's on trial. We've come to support him. No, he said, come on, let's know what's going on here. Let's know what's going on. So he said, well, that's what's going on. We've come here to support him. Now take it or leave it. So we let them go back in the public gallery. 2 minutes later, a fellow with all the braid on come and said, can I have a word, lads? Took them into the chamber and said, look, I can't apologise enough. He had no right to take you out of the public gallery and question you like that. You've got every right of the world to be here. And that was it. And that was it. What happened, sir, should have happened, and it should never happen again. It should never happen again. But what we've now, we've got lads coming here from abroad who have loved them, for a better living, and they're working but under the lamp. They're not even getting the rate of pay for their job. Once again, those at the top are getting all the cream. All the cream. And that, you know, and I just think it's a fall. But thanks for coming, I'm delighted. I don't know if there's anyone else to speak on behalf of the young
you're talking about nothing like this, and you said you weren't called like you were. Your brother was in the same ETO. He was the apprentice lecturer at the time on Mountfield. And when the police came around ward, they said, if you're asked to go home, and the bloke in charge of him, they got in the van, they went back to there. Jeff Bensberg was their leader at the time, the good shop shooting at the time. They went up there, well, they all got paid. And I was the day of the trial, I was like a lot more people, went outside to court in sympathy. We were photographed. I never worked in Shropshire. Then the next time I worked in Shropshire was 2006. I'd leave all together and worked all over the country, Scotland, worked offshore, with New South Wales, Mary Wells girl, and I'd come back with grandchildren. Plenty of people stopped and did absolutely nothing. So you could have gone out, you worked, and that was your choice. Loads of genuine people suffered in that who'd done absolutely nothing on.
You say your brother worked on the field?
Yeah.
Before?
MBB, Pennsylvania.
What was his name? Because I was working on
George. Didn't you hear that? George Mann.
Yeah, I know.
Well, he went home.
I don't think George was on the site. George was on the site.
You're not going to call me a liar. He went home. He was the best of time. The bloke, get in the van, we'll go. They went back to depot and they got paid.
I'm not looking to say I was there.
Well, he was there as well.
This has gone on all the time, though. We had the Grunwick, we've had Hillsborough, we've got Albury.
I'm sure
there's got so many.
Just take one more question over in the far side, and then we'll have to. We want you to come and see these documents.
Yeah, there's hope. Who's one? Alright. I didn't see a website on the front of the banner. I didn't have got a website with copies of these documents. That'd be useful to let people know if you've got one. If you haven't got one, do me after.
Please have that.
I wanted to just ask a question of Ricky, but I love that exchange. That's extremely useful. And I do appreciate your comments.
It's
And you pointed out that you wasn't called out on strike, and that's fine. There's I do think discussions like this are important, because sometimes the context of a meeting can even distort people's perception of what's fair and what's not fair.
Yeah.
And what I heard when you spoke, sir, was well, it wasn't all roses that day, and I was threatened. And when you was asked, well, what was the nature of the threat, you said you heard someone swear. The building site. I can take your point that it wasn't about the roses, but in terms of violence, threats, there's which is the context in which that criminal pursuit was pursued. Well, now that everyone's seen it and we can all tell truth from fiction, then we can see how even people who aren't part of the enemy get wrapped up in the strategy of the enemy because how finally to say, Ricky, I heard comments earlier about the support you got from the Morning Star, and I think that's worthy of pointing out. And the Morning Star still going strong now, of course, and I hope you, I don't know if you've got any words to say about what role he's played in part of your business.
Their reporter, Jim Wilson, never missed a single day at the trial. The only newspaper, the only reporter to be there every single day. And he wrote a lovely little book called The Shrewsbury Three, my full speech from the top, Jesse's full speech from the bottom. And I tell you what, try and get a copy and read them speeches, because it's coming through now. It's coming through. But thank you all very much indeed. God bless you.
107 News.